add to that introduction a little more. I have 14 years of experience, and that experience varied from all the. I started my IT career in a tester as a test engineer, and then moved to Oracle DBA, and then into AWS Cloud, DevOps, and then we started the machine learning into the operations world as well. So I'm here to share two of the problem areas in the operations world, which impacted our high availability metrics. Because for an operations, before that, do we have any system admins, application support engineers, or database engineers? Anyone here? Interesting. Okay, maybe the summit is for developers. That answers. Okay, so for the operations world, right, high availability of the systems, making sure that the systems are up and running 24/7, 365 days is very critical metric for us. And that's a very critical KPI for to define how effectively the operations team is functioning in any organization for that matter. For us, there are two problem areas. One is basically the predictive insights, where with regard to that is something like we are having the problems and then we are trying to do a firefighting, trying to solve it on a crisis bridges and to give a good customer experience when the business hour starts. The other one is we have some anomalies detected. Anomalies will be happening with regard to the load, transactions, what's coming from the other upstream and downstream systems. So we don't have any per se a solid metric or monitoring system where it can detect it and intimate us something has wrong happened, which was never seen in the past. That wasn't there. So these are the two areas which we have considered and developed some use case around it. Taking machine learning into the mix, and we could able to get AIOps as a whole into the Verizon, and I'm here to share those two use cases with you all. Okay, so before we jump in, let me get the context straight here with regard to the AIOps. What is required for the AIOps is basically, AIOps is all about artificial intelligence for operations. So for artificial intelligence, we need the data. And in the operations world, we have huge data, if you ask me. The data is varying from a clusters of systems, the physical servers, virtual servers in the cloud, on the on-prem, where every second or couple of seconds, they are generating the metrics. That metrics varies from CPU, the usage, CPU idle time, memory usage, storage, network, the Ethernet packets going back and forth to the systems where the transactions can be handled accordingly. And it can be more related to the application itself, where if you take an application WebLogic or WebSphere where the JVM is running, to the JVM itself, there will be more specific metrics like what are the garbage collection lag time, what is the JVM the CPU it is using. Pretty much, it's similarly, it will be happening for the database and then the MQ systems also. So if you look at it, the ecosystem will be having so many systems interconnected and each system is generating lots of metrics for us, which we can need to collate them and then have some insights generated using the machine learning algorithms. So for the first thing is what we need to have is the data collected accordingly. The other one is the data will vary, as I mentioned, it can go from logs, configuration data, it will be KPIs from the business itself for that matter, or it could be something about events or incidents, what is being generated from the systems and then getting created as a ticket in the other tools. Those are all the metrics we need to collect, and time series data for that matter. All those we need to have the multiple data types to be collected, and then we need to have the capability to have machine learning algorithms ran under that so that we can get predictive and prescriptive insights out of the data. And this system, AIOps system, should basically support both cloud and on-prem hybrid systems basically. Let's go with the first use case, what we have done in Verizon. If you take an application ecosystems, we have hybrid systems, compute, memory, and storage, network. It has got on the network side different routers, switches, Ethernet hubs. We have data, even data center management also, management systems also will generate the metrics that regard to the power consumption, efficiency, utilization, and then the temperature, what they maintain in the data center itself. Even that metrics is also required for us to make sure that and identify how the our systems are behaving. Because if the temperature is not maintained in the data center, the rack where our systems, servers are sitting, boxes are sitting, will be having high temperature increase. And that could eventually make sure, make that our systems go down. And that impacts the customer behavior, in customer behavior. And we have, for an application, we have both downstream and upstream ecosystem of application, because it's not something like the end customers is a bit dependent on only one system, because it will be a chain of systems connected together, which will give in what the business is, end customer's behavior. And we have multiple teams also. It's not something like I manage everything, my team manages everything. There, of course, that's not the case anywhere. The traditional monitoring, if you see, look at how things used to be. I'm being very pessimistic here, taking a comparison, but how it used to be basically is the Cron way of monitoring. We still have some of the systems monitored with Cron as well, apart from the other tools or third-party tools we have. In the Cron way of monitoring, each metric is monitored as a separate entity. There is no correlation. If CPU is monitored, CPU is just only CPU is monitored. And we will be having a static threshold saying that 80% is warning, 90-95% is critical, pretty much. That's straightforward. So whenever the CPU spikes one shot, one time, beyond 80 or 95, then accordingly we'll be getting usually a ticket raised or an email notification to the support teams. Where, because of this, what happens is, it just a spike in the load, no harm to the system as such. One spike, one email. So if you think, if you look at the scale of the application servers we have, what we had a problem was all our support folks who comes in the shift, right? We run a shift rooster cycle. They will be having lots of emails coming up. There you go. Thank you. False alarms. So what happens is they get to a mode, they saying that this is a normal alarm. I don't want to take care. And this system is always like this at this point in time. I don't really care. What happens with that thought process is, potentially because of so many alerts, there will be some alert which is a genuine alert, and we end up, because of this mindset of the support folks, we end up into a crisis situation. And the management will come back and say that, what happened? Don't we have a monitoring already set up? You do. But then what happened? Team missed it. So this was the answers, and those are the questions we have been posted, and these are the answers we were could able to give it. And then we thought that, no, this is not how it works. We should get something, some intelligence, some algorithmic way of detecting problem, and then try to solve it before even it ends up in a crisis. So what motivated for us this predictive insights is basically, we want to have the issue predicted before even it's going to occur in the near future. Not far future, at least going to be occurred in the near future. So what motivated us is basically, as I mentioned, there is no holistical way of system monitoring. App, web, DB are completely isolated systems. And in that individual system also, every metric is monitored individually. It's siloed way of getting things monitored, which is not right thing to do. And we don't have any predictive way of predicting, identifying the issues. It is basically we end up into the issue and then jump onto the crisis situation and then firefight the issues, calling them, paging them, and then calling, trying to fix the problem. And there is no correlation of the metrics at all. As everything is siloed, there is no correlation. How DB is behaving has no clue about how application is behaving. So there's complete disconnected. All the, then there are no dynamic thresholding. Everything is static. So that if there any load happens in a particular time of the window on a particular business day, that's not been captured initially. So it's all static way of getting things done. And insights on data center storage and network components has not been there. Even if you ask me now at this use case development, we are trying to have the calls with the data center management team and then try to get the access to their systems where they are saving this data so that we can embed the data into the model what we have. And of course, we don't have, before we didn't add the algorithm or intelligence to identify the problem. Problem, how we approach this predictive insights problem is basically, we consider this as a regression problem, where we would like to get the percentage of how the application is being degrading every 2 minutes of interval, what we have considered as a current model development. 2 minutes interval, if you ask me, is not the right thing to do. But that's how we have considered for now. The plan as an enhancement to this model is we need to get a streaming data flowing in so that we constantly get the prediction happening in a second or a couple of seconds as an aggregated value. So that's the enhancement we are trying to work internally as we speak. And we have considered 4 months of data as of now. And we are still assimilating the data for the maybe for 6 months or 1 year of data to have the data tell the story. 4 months is less for our systems, if you ask me, because we are pulling the data from third-party systems. If we ask them to store the data for a longer period of 1 month, the charge they're going to, the amount they're going to charge as part of the licensing is more. So we have, the management decided to end up having the data stored for 1 week, 7 days. And that 7 days we are keep on accumulating and saving into the cloud partner what we are supporting. That is S3, AWS S3. And that's what we're going to read it and then train the models. And we have got 130 features we have identified. And that 130 features is going to grow eventually. And these 130 features are basically an aggregated values of the cluster of boxes which an application or database system serves. Aggregation is not a good idea again, which we would like to expand those 130 into individual server metrics altogether. So that for one server, if you say CPU, memory, swap, network throughput, storage IO, processes, residual memory, virtual memory altogether comes at 20 or so, like that, into the cluster size itself. Cluster serves an average, it will be 30 servers, 50 servers, something in that range. So accordingly, the metrics are going to go larger. With that thought process into the mind initially, we went ahead with the deep learning approach, not the traditional approach. As the data growing, as the data is going to grow eventually, we started our journey of model development using deep learning itself. And as the data is growing, and the accuracy is looking good, but as the data is still growing, we would like to do one more model development using the traditional algorithm itself, like random forest or SVR. For that, we are doing the, again, prototype development, considering doing the feature engineering and identifying what are the features and what is the weight we can give to a feature based upon the SME knowledge. So we are doing that POC as of now. And for deep learning, we have used Keras API with the TensorFlow as a backend. So this is the flow, how we have, what we have got the model development done. It starts with collecting the historical data from all the components of an application. And then we're going to do some data pre-processing, including consolidating all the data, and then doing some one-hot encoding on the categorical data, which we pulled from the third-party systems. And then we did the data labeling manually. We did the data labeling manually. How we decided the labeling part is basically, we have considered the customer experience as the benchmark. For an application customer experience benchmarking, the one metric we could think of is response time. And a customer logs into our applications when it loads pages or do some activity on any of the components on the web page, how quicker the response is going to come back to him is the basic metric, or the primary metric, which should be considered for the customer experience. So we have considered web transactions average response time as a metric to do the data labeling for each observation, having 130 features as of now. We have ran the statistical analysis model on that, and then identified the how using the normalization distribution with outliers and then the IQR values. Accordingly, we have percentaged them and then marked the data labeling as this particular observation is 40% good. This person is basically 90% good. Accordingly, the historical data has been labeled. And then we gave the input, that data as an input to the model, where model learned based upon that data. And then we did some performance tuning with regard to trying different optimization. Adam, we tried. We tried SGL, some other model we have, optimizer we tried. We tried even regularization of dropout to make sure that the overfitting doesn't happen. We tried that, and then the optimizer model has been saved by looking at the mean square error, whichever is the, for whatever epochs it's coming as the least value, we considered that as an optimized model and saved that. That model has been loaded back for the real-time data, which is again 2 minutes consolidated data, because that's how the training data is being trained with, the model is being trained with. And then the model is going to predict for that particular 2 minutes of data, how well the system is right at that point in time. Whether it is 60% good, or it is going bad, the curve is basically going in a degraded way to the upward trend. And when the system, the prediction values is say, 70% is in bad state. That's a normal flow. Till this point is basically what the model predicts. Post that is all about workflow, how we have done it. Where 70% target is reached, based upon the history data, we're gonna have the dynamic thresholds defined within one standard deviation of plus and minus, so that we can have a moving threshold values. And whenever the threshold is crossed for consecutive 2 intervals, one shot, we don't care. If it is consecutively short, the threshold is short, overshoot for 2 intervals, that's when we're gonna send a notification and raise a ticket in our ticketing system saying that something is going to happen. There is a potential prediction that the potential issue is going to happen down the line in another 3 intervals or 4 intervals or 5 intervals of winter. Time that comes to each interval is 2 minutes for us. So it will be 10 minutes or 12 minutes, 14 minutes of time. Accordingly, it's going to give a percentage of degradation expected by doing an extrapolation of the prediction values. It's again not necessarily that indeed a real issue is going to happen. It is just a prediction we're going to give to the support teams so that they will get an alert they'll be alert, and then whenever an email comes from the model, they'll be more cautious. And then they may do a health check of the whole system, how the DB is doing, how the MQ is doing, how the app is doing. And accordingly, if there's a potential issue indeed they identified, then they could do the correction before even it go into a crisis situation itself. That's why we could able to proactively stop a crisis situation entering into a crisis situation itself. And coming to the metrics, what all we considered from the systems, the basic primary things, CPU, load, memory, and swap. On the network side, how many packets back and forth, the error counts, how many packets got dropped. And storage side, IO, inodes, read, write, and then the error utilization percentages, processes again, threads, how many each process is spanning the threads, how many threads are active, how many threads are in zombie state, how many are them in the sleeping state. And then the memory each process is consuming. And the right side of the basically the specific to JVM, what are the metrics we consider, and on the MQ side, and then the database side. If you see the metrics, we don't have any metrics on the data center related stuff, like power consumption, temperature, that's where we're about to add those ones we get from the other systems, other teams. These are the benefits what we have observed. Basically, the whole pipeline is automated, where it's going to learn from the new data. As it's going to do the prediction on the new data, it's going to learn from the history data, keep appending whatever is captured, and then it's going to keep training on the background. It basically saved the time for us so that support team are eventually logging to the system and then seeing that there's a potential issue might have happened if they have not logged in. Unlike the traditional way of getting things done where they log in and then decide that, okay, system is calm, it was just one spike. Then send a close the ticket saying that it's one off spike, I'm good. We potentially avoided the, saved the time there, and we could able to predict the issues before even the crisis situation, we enter into a crisis situation. And we have the AI here, we could able to correlate and learn from the historical data. And we could able to do get the insights on anomalies, performance issues. That's about predictive insights. Any questions? I'll stop here. Any questions on this part before I go to the next use case? Yeah.
So what did we learn here from the historical data? What is it different from the standard APMs that you've got there?
Standard APMs?
Application performance monitor that you
correct.
Have today.
Correct.
How is ML helping you really?
Correct.
To actually, as an add-on over APM, so you're getting some
alarms automatically.
Correct.
Which you are saying, again, that could be a probability of something happening,
correct,
which may not happen. So it could be, again, a false alarm. Now, how are you reducing the false alarms? And how is it different from APM? And where exactly we have applied ML? Why I'm asking this is the same issue I need to do. I need to do a predictive fault detection.
Okay.
Now, it's very easy to do in manufacturing or in any of your vehicles. There are sensors which do that. And in software, it's very difficult because we don't have those kind of sensors which are going to tell that software is going to fail tomorrow.
Correct.
It's only via logs some way that we are going to do.
Correct.
Again, the problems that you're facing is again false alarm. So again,
false alarms, yes, of course. In the operations world, the thought process what we have initially is in the operations world, it's not like that. We need to have an accuracy of 90%, 95% with a very not required. Because we are not dealing anything that critical here. Anyway, we have the support teams. What we are trying to achieve here is the time spent by the support team should be more productive. You're with me on that aspect of it. So the APM part is still, we do have APM. We have third-party tools. If I want to mention a few, is basically we have Logstash and Kibana.
Yeah.
We have New Relic.
Standard tools
we have AppDynamics. Pretty much those are the ones. Those are there. What we have in them is still application performance metrics of the application aspect of it, where we have got set of rules set. Rule set, whenever the rules are set there, whenever the rules are, the threshold set in the rules has been met, yeah, we're going to get an email. There is no correlation as such, how my MQ system is doing at that point in time, how my DB is doing at that point in time. What happens is with the APM is it going to monitor only the application behavior itself.
You can set the time series, right? Correlation also you can set there today.
On the APM application side itself, you're going to do it. On the only on the application metrics. What we are trying to do with the correlation aspect is basically, say for example, each metric on a system is very critical for us. Each metric for that matter. We can't do a feature engineering and saying that this metric is very important, this is not important. No, we can't do that on the operations world. Everything is important. So, application APM metrics are behaving bad. That could be because of my DB is having a blocker situation because of which one blocker is making the all other consecutive sessions to wait. That we can capture on the metrics. This the New Relic or APM, whatever the metrics we have, no? Those metrics, every second, 15 seconds what we have, it's going to capture it. If my model is being trained with that data also included in the training data set, the feature which is pertaining to the blockers or the waiters, that value is going to increase. Right? So that particular observation, the good observation and the bad observation instance, if you see it, this particular feature value is increased. When the real live data is given as an input, that feature, the blocker value is increased.
So that's where you're using ML.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. So that way, if the application as of now is behaving fine, but there is a buildup of issue happening on the DB side, which the 2 minute data what we are trying to aggregate is going to be captured as part of the real time 2 minutes data observation. Okay. And then the model going to predict saying that because of that, there is a potential issue might going to happen on the app side. You see the correlation how we have, that's the ML what we have done here.
The other thing is, are you able to predict the number of FTEs that you need or the number of support staff that you need based on the tickets volume that you have? That's a major challenge today in any production support or ops world. I don't know what is the flow of tickets that I'm going to. On one side, my FTEs are going to sit idle. On the other side, they're going to be squammed like crazy. And you're going to take that. And I think that's a universal problem. So are you working on that side or?
To answer this question, no. As of now, we are not. But we have that charted on the sheet, on the whiteboard to nail that problem as well. Glad that you asked me. I think we should be thinking offline and get the, this issue sorted out.
I'm
on the operation.
I'm not from Ops world, by the way. I'm not from Ops world. But I know.
Got it. Please, yeah.
Two minutes. So is it like you pick data after every 2 minutes in a window, or there is a moving average kind of thing that you?
No, we aggregate for at this point in time at 10 o'clock, I captured the data for the previous 10 minutes of data. From 10 to 10:02, we aggregate that data of 15 seconds what the New Relic and the other systems gonna keep capturing that. So we're gonna aggregate that 2 minutes of data, and then that becomes the 2 minutes observation live data to be inputted to the model to do the prediction for that 2 minutes.
Okay, and for the prediction, like you said, it can do for 2 minutes, 4 minutes, and even more. So is the same model which is doing multiple predictions, or you have got different?
No. When I say the prediction is basically the extrapolation, you see in the previous flow, right? The extrapolation, that's a workflow. There's no ML as such there. The ML stopped at this prediction itself. Post that, we have a small logic workflow where we're going to extrapolate. If the trend of the prediction is going towards bad state, it started with 50% bad, 55, 65, and then 70 hit. If it is increasing based upon the trend of the bad projection, we're going to extrapolate little further for the next consecutive 10 windows. 10 intervals, that becomes 20 minutes basically. Then accordingly, we're going to send a notification at the end saying that potential problem is going to happen after two consecutive intervals are breached. So that way, we potentially reduce the emails, and team also will be not spammed with so many emails, false alarms. It could be a false alarm, of course, but less when compared with the older fashion of getting things done. As of now, no. We piloted this. We are seeing good results. We are capturing the data for the history data, and we have the plan charted for applications which we prime the critical application which we have lined up.
Yeah, I think that could be one of your feedback back to your model, and it will keep learning.
True. Fair enough. Thank you.
Can you take this to phase two, where it can classify where exactly is the problem is, like, you know, whether it is database, it's app server.
Exactly. That thing is there. We are currently, as we are talking, we have that thing. The how we are envisioning it and how we are developing the model is basically, it should send a notification or raise a ticket pinpointing to which system of the complete ecosystem of the application is having a problem. And in that application, which component is in that system, which component is having a problem. On the database, if you ask me, is it the blocker having a problem, or is the active sessions high volume is having a problem, is the transaction load is having a problem. So that one step ahead onto the same thing is, we're going to plug in ultimately the self-heal component to integrating the self-heal component to the system itself. The model is going to give this system, this is the problem. Self-heal is going to take that input and then going to solve the problem automatically, so that even the support team no need to log into the box and fix the problem manually. That's the envision what we have, and we're currently working as we speak. Thank you. Okay. So next, I can take a couple of minutes, right?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. The next problem what we have is basically anomaly detection. This is the first one which we have tried, and the previous one what we have explained is the latest one. Okay. The problem here is the burning problem what we have here is, we already set the so many rules, alerts, everything is configured. If you see the number there, for the, all the critical systems what we support, we are currently getting around 30K email alerts per day, which is huge. And as I mentioned, we are ending up into missing the real problems and ending up into the crisis. So what we are trying to do is here to get some insights on what are the different, we don't want to go back to the so many applications, so many systems, try to collect the, correct the, do the work of which alert is important, which is not important. Okay, let's remove this alert, have this alert. That's like at that one point in time, we might have thought that that is required. And that is the reason it came into the system, that a particular alert. So we don't want to do that exercise. Instead, what we would like to do here is, we would like to bucketize all the different types of alerts. Bucketize the alert. Alerts could be hardly, I should say, around 20, 15, 18 buckets. That's spanning from high CPU alert, high storage alert, high network alert, maybe database related, transactions are high, active sessions are high, something like that. Or the, a particular service itself is down. The status is not matching, something like that. So what we have done here is, we took the 30 days of 30 alerts per day spanning across 6 months of data. And then we have ran the machine learning algorithm for topic modeling. This is the flow how it looks. Topic modeling. What we have currently is, all the systems which are generating the alerts are sending an input to the Elasticsearch with the subject line, so that the, we are saving everything for the future reference in the Elasticsearch, so that we can give some visualization using Kibana also. So Elasticsearch is the source for us for this particular data, where we're going to pull it from there. And then subject line will be having something like so-and-so system, this is the data center, and the problem is CPU is high, or the memory is low, something like that. So those subject lines are the plain English text, which we have taken as an NLP problem, and then we used NLTK and the SPASI libraries from Python. And then we basically did removing some stop words, did some lemmatization with regard to removing the punctuations, considering only the nouns, verbs, and adjectives and adverbs. Those things, we basically pre-processed the data. And then the pre-processed data, we have run the Gensim packets LDA model, which the output of that model is basically it's going to do a segregation of these alerts into different categories. And those categories, once the segregation has happened, we're going to save the model and checking multiple iterations of the model has been executed to identify what is having the good coherence score or the perplexity score. And then that model with the optimal number of buckets been considered, and then the model is saved. Then coming to the, again, the, when the real-time data is poured in, here we consider 5 minutes of interval data, not the streamlined as of now, for the real-time, even seconds or couple of seconds execution. So 5 minutes of data is given as an, to the model. The 5 minutes data of email alerts is going to split accordingly. The, these are the buckets. And these buckets will, one other thing is, the anomaly how we have done here is, we got the so many metric alerts, right? And that it will identify that for this 5 minutes of interval, CPU issues are around 10, memory issues are 20. Like that, we got the, all the numbers. On the statistical analysis way, we identified the IQRs which are outliers, 1.5 or 3 times of the IQR are marked as outliers. That, using that data, marked anomalies, where the new data is inputted and the model is segregating the data into different buckets, the number of alerts coming into each bucket for that interval of check will mark anything falling beyond IQR, the outlier section, and then we're going to send a notification to the team saying how it is benefiting us here. The support teams is, usually the alerts are there. There are so many are pouring. That problem is there. We are not trying to solve the problem of the root, which is like a laborious task for us. Instead, we are getting some machine algorithm on top of it to get some more insights to the team so that they will not miss it. The alert which this model is going to send to us will give an insight saying that there is an outlier or the behavior of the alerts pouring into the system is something abnormal at this point in time. I think there is a potential chance for you guys to go look into the system why CPU alerts are usually more than what it is supposed to be. Have a look into it, log into the system and check whether indeed the system is good or bad. So this gave some benefits to us saying by saving the time for the support team that when this alert comes, they will be very active and they'll do a due diligent effort to check and make sure that systems are in good state to avoid the outage. These are the different buckets the LDA model has segregated for our training data set in the real data set. And these are the few references which we have looked for, referred to get the model developed. Thank you.